Thank you very much for this opportunity to present our work. I am really excited to be here to share our experience in mechanistic models and machine learning in metal printing. The outline is simple. To start with, we want to define additive manufacturing, mechanistic models, and machine learning, so that all of us are on the same page about what we are discussing. And then the basic questions like why we need mechanistic models and machine learning, I would rather phrase it as why we cannot do without mechanistic models and machine learning, and examples of recent progress in both fields, and then a summary as to what this all means and what is in store based on evidence that we have collected over many years. So much of the work was done by current and former group members, and many of them are included here. What is additive manufacturing? In simple terms, it is making three-dimensional objects layer by layer. Sometimes these layers can be very thin, thinner than a human hair, maybe 30 micrometers in thickness. And a computer takes a three-dimensional design, slices it to many two-dimensional sections, and then decides on a traverse path to build these by melting a material and building a three-dimensional structure that is sometimes very complicated in shape. It may have site-specific chemical composition or complex internal channels. And the same equipment can produce many different types of parts on demand. That means as soon as the design is available, we can print it. There is no backlog between the design and manufacturing. So there are many different varieties of this particular process, additive manufacturing. Sometimes we call it 3D printing. One of them is called powder bed fusion. We start with very fine powders, maybe 15 to 50 micrometer in size, average diameter. And we have a bed of powder, and then we have a laser beam or an electron beam that melts specific locations. This is all controlled by the computer. And remember, the three-dimensional design was sliced into many two-dimensional sections. So it prints one time a two-dimensional section, and then above that two-dimensional section, it can print another two-dimensional section. So ultimately it becomes a three-dimensional part like this Nittany Lion, which is the mascot for our football team. So we have a bed of powder, and this bed can be lowered a little bit every time we build one layer, and new powders can be fed to this bed. And again, the laser beam traverses and prints a section of the three-dimensional part. Similar process can also be done by blowing powders, coaxial with a laser beam or an electron beam. And layer by layer, we can print three-dimensional parts. Also, we can use a welding torch that we call normally gas metal arc torch, in which we feed a consumable wire. The advantage of doing so is that the rate of deposition is fairly high. So we can make parts that are many, many kilograms very easily. Whereas if you look at the powder bed fusion, it takes a long time to do so. So productivity-wise, we can gain a lot by using an electric arc and a gas metal arc system. There are certain things that the additive manufacturing can do that other manufacturing cannot do. This GE jet engine fuel nozzle is one example. The picture on the right used to be made out of 21 separate parts. Now GE has set up a plant in Alabama and they are manufacturing this by powder bed fusion process in one step. So we don't need to make 21 different parts anymore. We get it all in one step, and GE thinks that it makes their jet engines much more reliable. Certain things like dissimilar metal welding is very widely practiced in nuclear power industry. For example, we sometimes weld a chromium molybdenum steel with a nickel alloy that we call 800H. And these dissimilar ferritic austenitic joints is causing some problem. In this dissimilar joint, once we heat it for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, carbon diffuses away from near the joint. And that causes a creep degradation and the parts eventually fail. So a solution to that is to have a compositionally graded joint in which, as a function of location, the composition varies. On one side, we can have a chromium molybdenum steel. On the other side, we can have a nickel alloy. And in between, we have a graded composition. This can be easily made in additive manufacturing. But in common welding, we cannot do that. So what this does is that it sets up a gradient of carbon potential that reduces the diffusion of carbon. So the degradation of the creep property that is common in dissimilar welds is not a problem for compositionally graded alloy. So this is only possible by additive manufacturing, not possible by conventional welding. And then remote production, as soon as a design file is available, is another character. Here is an example. This is a picture on the right of the captain of the International Space Station. They needed a ratchet wrench, and there was no supply mission planned by NASA at that time. So what NASA did, they took a 3D design and sent it electronically to a small desktop printer inside the International Space Station. And they remotely printed a 104-layer plastic ratcheting wrench together with all the moving parts in place. So here are three examples of components that three-dimensional additive manufacturing process can print that other conventional processes cannot do. And this is the reason why I think additive manufacturing is going to get hold in the industrial world. So what is mechanistic modeling? Why do we need mechanistic modeling and machine learning? Mechanistic modeling is a mathematical description of a physical process. Say I'm heating a bed of powder with a laser beam, and I want to calculate what's the temperature there, because the temperature will determine my cooling rates, and the cooling rates will determine the microstructure and properties. So a mechanistic model will connect the process variables like speed, power, particle size, powder feed rate, all of those variables to product attributes like what type of microstructure it has, what's the property, and so on. An example of this type of modeling is calculation of temperature field. And how do we do that? We do that by solving the equations of conservation of energy mass and momentum. Why momentum? Because once we melt the powder, it forms a pool of liquid, and that pool of liquid moves. And as it does, it carries a lot of heat. And so there is a temperature and velocity field that is set up that determines the geometry of the fusion zone, the cooling rate, and the microstructure and properties of the material that we are depositing. So this can be done very easily using a modeling, whereas because the liquid pool is opaque, we cannot determine temperatures inside the pool experimentally. So something mechanistic model can do that's difficult to do by experiments. In the virtual world, there are lots of emerging tools that have the capacity to radically change the way we investigated and solved problems. One other such tool is machine learning. Machine learning is primarily data-driven, and the data can be generated by a physical model, or data can be generated by experiments, or data can be generated when we do a printing. So we gather a bunch of data and we analyze them, and we try to correlate our processing conditions with the attributes that we want to determine. So here is an example. Here we are trying to do a neural network for welding to calculate weld penetration. And why weld penetration? Because it tells us whether we can weld a thin plate or a thick plate. Unless the penetration is sufficient, we cannot weld a very thick plate, right? So what we do is we do a whole bunch of experiments, and we correlate the depth of penetration of the welds for different speeds of the heat source, like a laser beam or an electron beam. We can consider the power of the beam and many other varieties of parameters and correlate them to what we actually observe. And then we take that data, fit it in a neural network, and now the neural network can take all those parameters and instantaneously tell us what the depth would be. What's the purpose if we have already done the experiment? It's very rapid. It's very quick. So as soon as in a shop, we have a set of data that we think we are going to use to make a part, we can fit those into the neural network to check whether everything is going to be fine, whether we are going to get a peak temperature, where we are going to get a pool of certain dimension. So whatever we may like to investigate, we can teach a neural network to do. Neural network is just one type of machine learning tool. Together with mechanistic modeling and machine learning, we can do a lot of things that experiments would not be able to tell us. The real question is, can we do without modeling and machine learning? Both can provide parameters like temperatures that are difficult to measure experimentally. Both can reduce trial and error testing that are useful for developing insights and understanding. So what kind of trial and error testing is needed? Well, I do a 3D printing and I find there are lots of porosity, or I find that the aluminum part has cracked. Wouldn't it be nice if I knew before doing that experiment that the parameters I'm going to use is not going to work? That will save me a lot of headache. And this is exactly what the mechanistic modeling and machine learning is capable of doing. So if we don't make use of it, we do so at our own peril, because they are enormously useful. Now, some people sometimes ask me, can MATSE, material science and engineering, do all that? Well, The simple answer is these emerging tools empower MATSI. They are part of MATSI. If we adopt them for investigations of MATSI, they give us new abilities to inquire that we didn't have before. Like MATSI can correlate process, microstructure, properties, and performance. But MATSI cannot actually tell us what would be the microstructure of a part if I use so much of laser power, so much of speed, so much of powder size, so much of powder feed rate, and so on. These are in the domains of emerging tools of the digital world, and they are enormously powerful. So mechanistic models and machine learning models can solve problems that cannot be solved by any other means. And I am here to share our limited experience on both of these, highlights from our previous work on mechanistic modeling and machine learning. And this is very important because if you look at the literature on additive manufacturing, you will find people use a whole variety of heat input, which is the ratio of power to speed. They get a very different range of cooling rates. Cooling rates can vary from less than 100 degrees Kelvin per second to more than a million degree Kelvin per second. And you know that the cooling rate affects microstructures and properties. So depending on the process conditions, we can get a wide variety of microstructures and properties. And there has to be some way better than just doing and seeing, because doing and seeing is not inexpensive in this process, because the cost of these machines for additive manufacturing, they are not inexpensive. And the feedstocks, the powders and wares that we use are also very expensive. So we need a paradigm that is not simply based on trial and error. Do it and see if we get a good part. If not, do another time and now see whether the part is any better or worse. I mean, this is not a viable alternative for a very expensive machine and feedstock combination. Similarly, the temperature gradient and solidification growth rate also that have been reported in the literature vary widely. And therefore, you cannot really control it by trial and error. So you need other tools. Mechanistic modeling and machine learning empower you to take control. And it can save money, it can expedite the qualification of parts, it can allow you to make parts of better quality. So capabilities of verifiable mechanistic models. Verifiable is very important. If you develop a model, the model has to be tested adequately so that you can trust it. So I'm showing some of the capabilities of a mechanistic model of 3D printing. An example can be a heat and fluid flow model. We provide input. So input can be process variables like speed, power, powder feed rate, and the type of additive manufacturing and so forth. And the mechanistic models can give us temperature fields, cooling rates, solidification growth rates, temperature gradients. So it can tell us the grain structure, microstructure, some simple defects, and residual stress and distortion as well. So it has a lot of capabilities. So how does one develop a mechanistic model of 3D printing like I'm talking about here, heat transfer and fluid flow model? So please allow me to explain. Here is a wall that is being built by additive manufacturing on a base plate. And we divide this entire domain into many small rectangular parallelepipeds. And in each of these cells, we solve equations of conservation of mass, momentum, and energy. So we are basically solving Navier-Stokes equation and energy equation by converting them to linear equations for each cell. And we provide as input process parameters like speed of this heat source, power, and other variables, and material properties. And as output, we get transient temperature field, velocity field, solidification parameters like temperature gradient, solidification growth rates, and so on. And let's assume that the calculation domain contains about 250,000 cells. And we are solving for 5 variables, 3 components of velocities, pressure, and enthalpy. If we have 5 variables and 250,000 cells, we will have 1.25 million algebraic equations. If we do 100 iterations at any time step, we are looking at about 1/8 of a billion equation per time step. And if we take 1,000 time steps, the total will be 125 billion total equations. How long do you think it will take? In an inexpensive laptop, you can solve a few billion equations per minute. So let's say my $800 laptop can do 2 billion equations per minute, I will need about an hour. And after about an hour, I have everything. I have temperature, velocity field, solidification parameters, anywhere you want at any time. Here is a typical output we get. The shape and size of the liquid pool, the velocity patterns, and if you look at half of the whirlpool that we are showing on the bottom left corner, the liquid metal seems to be flowing from the middle to the periphery. And this flow is generated by the spatial gradient of interfacial tension, known as the Marangoni stress. And this flow carries a lot of heat. So for example, if you look at the upper right-hand corner, the liquid on the right side of this cross-section is having a clockwise flow, and the liquid on the other side is having an anti-clockwise flow. And this flow carries a lot of heat. And this heat determines the shape and size of the fusion zone. Typically, the velocity during 3D printing is about 50 to 300 centimeters a second. If you compare that to 100 meter sprint, where people go a kilometer in 10 seconds, it's way slower than that. But this cartwheeling of the liquid metal is very important because it determines the shape and size of the fusion zone, the temperature field, the cooling rate, and the microstructure and properties of the fusion zone and beyond. So what is it we are determining? Fusion zone geometry is one parameter, temperature velocity fields, cooling rates, temperature gradient, solidification growth rates, and a whole bunch of non-dimensional parameters that provide insight about what is going on during the processing. Using the computed values, we can also determine features of microstructures like grain structures, pore structures, solidification structures, and using the temperature field, we can determine thermomechanical parameters like residual stress, distortion, and other factors. And these calculations that we can do in a matter of an hour or two is critically important, particularly if we can make use of the modeling before we print the actual part, because it can save us a lot of trouble. Most people think that if you melt a material with a high intensity beam, like a laser beam, you will get a hemispherical pool, right? Like the one on the left here. But that is not true. Sometimes you can get a bracket. Sometimes you can get a shape that is about like W, or you know, other shapes that are not shown here. How can we know? And why is it important for us to know? First of all, it's very important for us to know because we are binding one layer with the previously deposited layer. So if we don't know what the fusion zone shape and size looks like, we are not sure that we are going to have adequate bonding with the previous layer. Whereas you can see that depending on Prandtl number and Marangoni number, your shapes can be very different. And you can calculate these. You cannot predict it from other theories of Matsai as to what the shape and size of diffusion zone would be or what the temperature would be without doing a solution of energy equation and Navier-Stokes equation. So it's important. If you have a small amount of surface active elements like sulfur, oxygen, selenium, tellurium, nitrogen, that are commonly present in steels in very small quantities. So most of the time, the difference between 20 parts per million of sulfur or 150 parts per million of sulfur is, it can be the same grade of steel. But if you have a little more sulfur, your flow pattern can be very different because sulfur affects the interfacial tension and therefore the Marangoni convection. So a steel with a small amount of sulfur may have a wide and shallow pool, whereas a steel with a little more sulfur can have a deep and narrow pool simply because of the way heat is transported. For the one on the right, the just below the laser beam, the energy is going downward, and so you get a drilling effect and you get a deeper pool and a narrower pool. Whereas the one with very low amount of sulfur, the fluid flows from the middle to the periphery and you get a wide pool and a shallow pool. So it does matter as to what the heat transfer and fluid flow does. So pool geometry in different additive manufacturing processes like DED, directed energy deposition gas metal arc, and directed energy deposition laser or powder bed fusion laser can be predicted. What may not be apparent just by a casual look is that this scale is much larger than that one. So from left to right, the top left-hand picture shows a distance of about 20 millimeter, whereas the bottom one shows only 0.4 millimeter. So this is powder bed fusion. The pool is going to be much smaller than that in the gas metal arc welding system. So you can deposit a lot more material. In each case, if you compare the cross section that is measured after doing an experiment and with the one that you predict, you can see there is reasonable agreement between the predicted values and the experimentally measured values for all these different systems. So convective heat transfer calculations can predict the fusion zone geometry in both directed energy deposition and powder bed fusion systems. Same thing can be said about the measured and the predicted thermal cycles. You can see that the temperature changes with time at a particular location because we are depositing it layer by layer. So when the heat source comes above this monitoring location, the temperature peaks. When the heat source goes away, temperature drops, peaks again when the new layer is deposited, and this complicated thermal cycle is the reason why grains grow and phases undergo transformations, and ultimately we get a particular set of microstructure and properties. For every alloy, this is different. So we determine experimentally sometimes the effect of peak temperature in the fusion zone as a function of laser power, as is shown in the picture on the left. And on the right, we are showing calculated values as a function of time. And when we compare the computed peak temperatures with the experimentally observed peak temperatures, they show similar trend. And so we believe that the thermal cycles we calculate, where we cannot measure the temperatures as a function of time and position, they are also trustworthy. They have, of course, implications. The cooling rates affect the microstructures. One simple parameter that we can check is the secondary dendrite arm spacing in stainless steel. So for different laser powers, we have different secondary dendrite arm spacings from experiments, from the microstructure, as well as from calculations. So we can see that simple features of microstructure can be predicted. So calculated values are very reliable. Grain growth, depending on what the process parameters are, we can have changes in the grain structure from columnar to equiaxed grains. Depending on location also, there can be variations. And depending on process parameters like speed, effect of speed is shown here. Those can be very reliably simulated using computational models. Defects can be simulated as well. If we don't have adequate melting of the feedstock, there can be gaps between the tracks, and those gaps will show up as porosity and lack of fusion. And this is easily preventable because, you know, higher power or slow scanning, in other words, high heat input per unit length, will mean bigger pools. And bigger pools will mean less lack of fusion defects. So lack of fusion defects can be prevented using modeling. So what is it we are saying? We can calculate temperature and velocity fields. We can use them for understanding microstructure, properties, defects. We can also look at residual stresses. 3D transient heat transfer fluid flow model can give us temperature and velocity fields for the entire domain, not just the fusion zone. So those transient values, together with the mesh and the temperature field, can be fed to a thermomechanical model like Abaqus to calculate residual stress, strain, and deformation of the entire domain. So we can know if the part is going to be bent out of shape or if the geometrical specifications are going to be met. So stainless steel 316 made by DEDGMA, DED laser, and powder bed fusion laser, we have computed here. And here we are looking at the effect of composition of the material on the residual stress. And you can see that depending on the material and processing variables, we can have low residual stress or high residual stress. If you look at DDGMA, which has a very high deposition rate, you are also going to get a high residual stress. But if you do powder bed fusion, the process by which GE makes their jet engine fuel nozzles now in Alabama, those have very low residual stress. And you could have predicted that by doing numerical simulation. And also you can compare nickel alloy 718 versus titanium alloy, titanium 6, aluminum 4, vanadium. This one has a lot more residual stress than here. So these are tools that give you a lot of ability to probe things that are difficult to measure. And you can do so before doing the experiment. So it's enormously empowering. So machine learning, I'm changing here. These are data-driven relations without any mechanistic understanding. Nowadays, we also do hybrid, in which we make use of the data-driven relations, but we empower a mechanistic model to generate some of the data. That way, it is physics-informed machine learning. So it's not totally devoid of basic understanding. We can assimilate the basic understanding, but it's still the correlation among data that we are looking for. So I will give you three examples. So let's say that we have a thermo camera, infrared camera, if you will, and we take pictures as a function of time. And this picture can give us the periphery of the fusion zone based on the solidus temperature contour. We have, as a function of this angle theta, the temperature or the distance where we have a temperature of T solidus for this alloy. And if we plot it, radial distance versus angle for the T solidus, the profile looks like this. And this signature we can put in a machine learning algorithm, and we can use a classifier to see whether there will be defects or no defects. And in this particular case, we are looking for maybe a lack of fusion defects. So in the red zone, which is below this curved line, if we take any point, and then we go back to this specimen, we do an experiment under these conditions and look for the microstructure, we can see the lack of fusion defects here. So you see, it can be verified. So this is one type of use of the machine learning that we are using. A second type can be pool geometry control, because the geometry is very important. So let's say we have a whole bunch of measured data. So we have on the y-axis track width versus laser power for a whole bunch of scanning speeds, the speed by which the laser beam moves. And we have this data set. We can feed this data set to train a neural network. So track width versus measured track width. So track width, that the neural network that we have trained, calculated versus the measured track width, and we get more or less a good fit. And therefore that neural network can tell us, without doing any more experiment than we have already done, what would happen for a given speed and power. And that is very useful on the shop floor. Before doing the experiment, we know what to anticipate based on scientific principles. Microstructure control is always a very important goal for materials people, right? For MATC. So what do we do here? We have a 3D grain growth simulation using Monte Carlo method. And we take a section of that on any given plane, and we digitize the data frequency versus size, and then feed that into a machine learning program. And therefore, we know grain size can be predicted. So if we have the trained network, then we can use that to do prediction of average grain size for a particular processing conditions. And that is enormously useful. Where would one get those codes? It's all taken from a recent review in Nature Reviews Materials. It's a journal where we published this work, a review paper this year, several months ago. And we have included in there resources for people who want to get started. And we only included the open source programs where the source codes are available, where there is extensive manuals, so that you can get started if you want to do this in a matter of weeks. You don't have to develop a code. You don't have to deal with a black box. There is a manual, and there are a whole bunch of those now available from Weka, Scikit, TensorFlow, Keranas, and Theano. And we have included all the websites from where you could download these and the utility of those. Like, you could do image classification, and using that, you can do defect determination, okay? Or you can monitor printing speed, or you can check on dimensional accuracy of additively manufactured parts, or you can predict distortion, prediction of part weight, and all kinds of good things. These resources enable people to get started very quickly. So in summary, if you look at machine learning and mechanistic modeling and the synergistic metallurgical database, you can start from product design to process planning to production, during which you monitor certain parameters and control the quality. You control defects, microstructure, properties. Then after you build your part, the part has to be qualified for it to be used in a particular application, like for aerospace, you need permission to use it in an airplane as a part, and then ultimately the performance. So if you look at where the applications have been, machine learning has found applications in product design, process planning, in production, monitoring, and control, in defects, almost all aspects of these. And similarly, mechanistic model can help us with process selection, whether we are going to be using powder bed fusion or directed energy deposition systems for a particular part that we seek to make, and what kind of parameters we can monitor in order to control the quality, how can we reduce defects, what microstructural control can we exercise. And so this summary chart tells us the ability of machine learning and mechanistic model in providing high quality parts rapidly without too many trial and error for additively manufactured parts. So I want to make a few predictions based on evidence. I think that there is going to be expanded adaptation of additive manufacturing in diverse industries in the near future. And my evidence for saying so is the trend of the sales data. How many machines are being sold and the revenue growth, printing of more alloys would be possible. You know, there are about 5,600 commercial alloys. If you look at how many alloys we print in additive manufacturing, it's just a handful. Out of those 5,600 alloys, we probably print not more than 10. That's a very low number, right? Small and medium businesses don't participate in this because of the need for large capital investment. And there are lots of scientific, technological, and commercial problems that still needs to be solved. Only large corporations have the resources and the manpower to be able to solve those problems. So most of the additive manufacturing field is now dominated by the GEs and Siemens and large Boeings and other companies. But a time will come when we are going to be solving these problems, scientific, technological, and economic problems at a faster pace. So I think small and medium businesses will get in, and then there will be even more activities in additive manufacturing. Additive manufacturing will not follow the path in which science and technology matured in the past. How did we come to the rich knowledge base of metallurgy and material science? Through experiments, empirical testing. That is not the path for additive manufacturing. Empirical testing is very expensive, very slow, and we have better ways. I think mechanistic models and machine learning will expedite development of additive manufacturing and contribute to the development of material science. Can you think of improving ductility and strength at the same time? Normally, most people think that if you increase ductility of a material, you are making this soft, so your strength will go down. If you increase the strength, material becomes hard, it becomes less ductile. But can you do both? In some cases, you can. Not always. Most of the time, you cannot. But the fact that we are talking about it, and the fact that in some cases we can do this, gives us hope of the underlying science that we are discovering. Synergistic factors for growth, rich knowledge base of metallurgy, developed mostly by empirical testing, emerging tools of the virtual world. There is a vast virtual world of which the mechanistic models and machine learnings are just two tools, and they are changing the game. And also, there is technologically oriented global workforce. That's another important factor. Thank you very much for listening.